Welcome to Springside Baptist Church's online service. We're glad that you're joining us today. Here are a few announcements as we start off. We're going to be celebrating communion near the end of the service, so be ready with the necessary items if you'd like to participate with us. A prayer meeting is taking place every Wednesday at 7 p.m. at our church building. We're following the provided guidelines, but it is so exciting to gather in person again and to focus on prayer and talking to God. We're also looking at the details of restarting worship services soon. And so we want to hear from our church family about how best to move forward with these Sunday church gatherings. We'll be having an information meeting regarding reopening where you can share ideas and volunteer to help in the different new areas. It's going to be July 9th at 7 p.m. And if you call SBC home, we would love to see you there to contribute towards our reopening plan. The church board is aiming for July 19th as the tentative date to begin worship services again, and we'll discuss that and many other items during this informational meeting. Last thing, you noticed previous week that we had some wedding anniversaries that we wanted to let you know about. Well, this coming week, Dan and Crystal Darrell will be celebrating their 50th wedding anniversary on July 11th. So on behalf of your SBC family, happy anniversary. Have a wonderful time celebrating this amazing milestone. As we begin our service today, I'd like to read a passage out of Matthew chapter 11. In it, we see this. At that time, Jesus declared, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for such is your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all who are who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Jesus calls us to him in this passage to experience connection and life with him, the Father, and the Spirit. He offers us rest from our burdens of sin. And in this passage, it describes a yoke, and a yoke helps ease the discomfort of carrying a heavy load. But it also symbolizes obedience and really an acceptance of responsibility. And so Jesus' yoke is one that calls us to follow him. His yoke is easy and light, not because his call to discipleship is less demanding, but because we are followers of one who is gentle and humble in heart. And so let's praise God for the splendor and the significance and the experience of those truths.
Good morning, Springside Baptist Church. We're glad you've joined us today. We are the Buellers. I'm Kendall, my wife Amanda, my daughter Tabitha, and Benjamin on the guitar. We want to lead you in worship today, and one of the things that we made a practice of as we were pastoring a church in the past was right around Canada Day, either the Sunday before or after, we would do our national anthem as one of our opening songs for that Sunday morning. So this morning, we will carry on our tradition, and we'll ask that you join us standing up where you are, and if you're able to join us by standing, please sing with us our national anthem, O Canada.
O Canada, our home and native love, in all thy sons command, with glowing hearts we see thee rise, the true north strong and free. From far and wide, O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. God keep our land. and free. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee. Oh, Canada, where pines and maples grow, great prairies spread, and lordly rivers flow. How dear to us thy broad domain, from east to western sea, thou land of hope for all who toil, thou true north, strong and free. God keep our land glorious and free. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee. Ruler supreme, who hearest humble prayer, hold our domain within thy loving care. Help us to find, O God, in thee a lasting rich reward, as waiting for the better day we ever stand on guard. God keep our land glorious and free. Oh, Canada, we stand on guard for thee. Stand on guard for thee.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son not sparing sent him to die, I scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
We're going to take some time to pray. And so here are some ideas to start with. Praise God for His grace in your life and how He creates growth in us. Confess anything burdening your heart that is impacting your journey with God. Lift up those to God who are disadvantaged and ask how the church can be an instrument of change in our world. Ask for discernment for yourself and for others. Pray for someone that God places on your heart. Ask for strength to practice the truth in love. So take the next while, talk to God either individually or with those around you about these things or other things as the Spirit lays on your heart. And I'll close our time after a few moments. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can praise you, that we can worship you in spirit and truth. Father, you are one who has created all things, things that we see throughout our everyday life, things that we can observe on a microscopic level and on a level that is so beyond us in the universe. You have made things so complex and so intricate and yet so beautiful. Father, we praise you for loving humanity enough to send your Son, that we might be restored to you, that we might be rescued from death to life and experience relationship with you again. Father, we thank you for the Spirit that empowers us, that indwells us, that we can experience your presence and walk in the ways that you call us to. Father, you've heard the prayers of your sons and daughters this morning. Lord, we lift up those that are hurting, those who are burdened with heavy loads. Help us to see the calling of Jesus to be able to find rest in him. And for those around us that we see that are heavy laden, we ask that you would give them peace and rest, and that we would in some way be able to explain to them and live it out for them what it means to find rest in Jesus. And so, Father, we give you all of these things, knowing what is in our hearts, knowing what has come out of our mouths to talk to you about. And we ask that you would do things so that you might be glorified and you might be recognized for the amazing, good and great God that you are. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hello, I'm Ariel. I've got something to show you this morning. You know what this is, right? Sure, it's toothpaste. Do you use toothpaste when you brush your teeth? Me too. Well, let me tell you about the time a boy named Joey went into the bathroom to brush his teeth. He got out his toothbrush, took the cap off the toothpaste tube, and he began to squeeze a little onto his toothbrush. Is that the way you do it? Me too. But he squeezed the tube a little too hard and way too much toothpaste came out and fell into the sink. He looked at it and said, "Hey, that was kind of fun." So he squeezed a whole lot more into the sink. Just then, his mom knocked on the bathroom door and said, "Joey, you're not playing with the toothpaste, are you? Uh-oh, Joey's in trouble." So Joey took his finger and quickly tried to put the toothpaste back into the tube. As hard as he tried, the toothpaste just wouldn't go back in. Do you think we could get all this toothpaste back into the tube? I don't think so. Perhaps you should try this at home. First, ask a parent. Once you get the toothpaste out, you can't get it back in. Just like hurtful words, if you say something hurtful to someone, it comes out of your mouth and you can't put it back in. Now we can apologize if we say something mean, but the best thing is not to let hurtful words leave our mouths in the first place. The Bible says Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in the sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Psalms 19:14. So next time you brush your teeth, remember, don't let too much toothpaste come out of the tube. And don't let hurtful words leave your mouth, because in both cases, you can never get them back in. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pray that the words that we speak and the thoughts that we have will be pleasing and acceptable to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Hello. Today we turn our attention to the Word of God once again. We come to this part of our worship service where we have the privilege of opening the Word of God, and we are once again in the book of Ephesians. We are coming close to the end of the book of Ephesians. We will be in Ephesians chapter 6, starting with verse 10 today. And let me just emphasize what a critical piece this is to living life as a follower of Jesus. Ephesians 6, verses 10 through 20 really provide us with important truth to help us stand and move forward in battle as followers of Jesus. And so let's read that word today. Ephesians chapter 6, starting with verse 10. This is the word of the Lord. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints, and also for me, that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. Would you pray with me as we look at the Word of God this day? Father, we do give you thanks and praise for your Word of truth. We thank you so much for the things that you have been teaching us through this letter of Paul to the Ephesians. We pray, Lord, that you would just help us to set aside those things that would distract us from your truth today. Help us to receive your truth graciously and to apply it diligently in our lives, that we might become the disciples of Christ that you have called us to be. Father, towards that end, we ask that you would be glorified, that Jesus would be exalted, and that each of us would be strengthened in our faith in you this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I've entitled the message for this day, Armed and Ready. As Christians, we are engaged in a daily battle, and there is an urgent need for us to be armed and ready. Listen to what Warren Wiersbe says in his book, What to Wear to the War, Studies from Ephesians 6. And I quote, "Some people reject the military side of the Christian life. I appreciate those who want to see peace on earth. However, as long as sin exists in this world, the battle between Satan's forces and God's people will rage on. Anyone who chooses to be on the side of the Lord Jesus Christ will face severe opposition from Satan and from his followers. And those who refuse to fight will fall in the heat of the battle. The Bible frequently uses the image of war to depict the Christian life. Paul exhorted Timothy to be a good soldier of Jesus Christ. In fact, the first picture our Lord gave of the church was a military one. He told the disciples that the gates of hell would not prevail against the church. We find that in Matthew 16, verse 18. In ancient times, a common military tactic used by armies was to break down the gate of an enemy's fortress with a battering ram. Once inside, they could then destroy the opposing army. Likewise, Jesus told us that Satan and his forces are not able to withstand or prevent the onward march of Christianity. The church will win the war. Wiersbe continues, "The Christian life is not a playground, it is a battleground." And whether we like it or not, every Christian is called to be a soldier and to fight the good fight. No soldier enters a battle without being fully prepared and protected. Likewise, God does not expect us to go to war unarmed. He has given us the armor and weapons we need for the fight, and he expects us to use them. End of quote. Ephesians 6, 10 through 20 gives us a list of equipment and tells us how to use it. Enemies in this life are a reality, and we cannot deal with them by simply ignoring them, pushing them aside. They need to be faced head on. Also, we cannot effectively deal with our enemy in our own human strength. When a person comes into a saving relationship with Jesus Christ, Satan is not pleased. In fact, he will stop at nothing to attempt to knock them down, wear them down. That is his goal when it comes to his working on the follower of Jesus. The enemy within the spiritual realm is tenacious, and we would do well to remember this and to take him seriously. The advantage available to us is that God has given us the resources and the tools to be able to withstand the enemy's attack. It is crucial that we hear the Word of God as it is presented today, and that we use it in our lives every day. This is an urgent matter that ought not to be taken lightly. Are you ready to do battle with the enemy? Have you equipped yourself with the armor that God has provided? Today we will study what Paul says about the armor of God. We will hear him imploring the Ephesian believers, and as he does so, he implores us. He implores us to put on the full armor of God. It is urgent that we be ready to engage in the spiritual battle. Pray that each of us will be moved by the truth of today's message to equip ourselves to engage in the spiritual battle before us. Paul began his message to the Ephesians by calling them to be strong. The strength that he called them to was to be strong in the Lord. In other words, they were to put their faith in him, not in their own strength. They were to depend on the Lord for the strength they needed to face the enemy. They were to trust in the strength of his might. Paul implied that the Christ follower's strength lay in the Lord alone. It was his strength that was the ultimate strength. There was no other place that they could find the strength that would help them in this battle. Therefore, he urged them to walk in the strength of the Lord. He went on and told them to put on the whole armor of God from foot to the top of their head. He told them to put on the whole thing. By this, he was indicating that there was something they could do, and that was to be intentional and specific about putting on this divine armor. The reality for them was that when they did so, they would have everything they needed to be able to stand against the devil and his schemes. The devil was deceptive and operated within the realm of lies. He would use any and all kinds of means to try and make them fall. This was all the more reason for them to put on the full armor of God. In verse 12, Paul proceeded to describe the nature of the devil. In doing so, he urged these followers, his fellow Christ followers, to know the enemy. This need to know would help them as they daily engaged the enemy in battle. Paul made it clear that the enemy was not flesh and blood. It was not someone they could see with their physical eyes. Satan was spirit, and as such, he showed himself in the spirit realm, in the rulers, the authorities, the cosmic powers over the present darkness, and the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. This was the one against whom they wrestled, and it was only with the strength that God could provide for them that they would stand. When they followed Paul's instructions, they would be equipped to engage in the spiritual battle. This, says the Lord through his servant Paul, is the struggle that faces the dedicated follower of Jesus Christ. That is why we also are called to be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Walking with the Lord every moment of every day will enable us to walk and to stay strong in him. Trusting in him and relying on him to give us what we need at any moment will translate into us being strong in the Lord. We too need to take seriously the putting on of the full armor of God. The devil's countdown clock continues to tick, and he is desperate to make as many Christians as possible fall. He uses deception and lies to drag us down to his level. Being dressed in God's full armor will help us to stand in the midst of all the devil's schemes. Then, we need to be aware of who the enemy is. The enemy is not, and I repeat, is not flesh and blood. It is a part of our nature to make flesh and blood the enemy. However, our enemy is to be found in the spiritual realm. Our enemy is to be found in the unseen forces of the rulers, the authorities, the cosmic powers over this present darkness, and the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. As soldiers of Christ, these are forces that we struggle against. It is crucial that we ask the Lord for his help and rely on him to give us the strength to do the battle. Are you ready to engage in this spiritual battle? Then take the teaching we have received so that you can be equipped to engage in whatever battle confronts you. Here's a true story. A Christian leader, we'll call him Steve, was traveling by plane. He noticed that the man sitting two seats over was thumbing through some little cards and moving his lips. The man looked like a professor with his goatee and graying brown hair, and Steve placed him at 50-something. Guessing the man was a follower or a believer, a fellow believer, Steve leaned over to engage him in conversation. "Looks to me like you're memorizing something," he said. "No, actually, I was praying," the man said. Steve introduced himself. "I believe in prayer too," he said. The stranger said, "Well, I have a specific assignment," said the man with the goatee. "What's that?" Steve asked. "I'm praying for the downfall of Christian pastors." "I would certainly fit into that category," Steve said. "Is my name on the list?" "Not my list," the man said. Our enemy is very real, and is scheming of ways to destroy each one of us. He often attacks those in leadership. That is why it is critical to support our leaders with regular and fervent prayer. The enemy is prone to attack anyone who follows Jesus. In a clear sense, we all have the responsibility to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. In this we are called to lead, and therefore targets of the enemy. The wonderful thing is that our Lord has provided us with what we need to overcome the devil's schemes. Walk with the Lord and be strong in the strength of His might. This will help you to be ready for whatever the enemy brings your way. Take the truth you've heard this day. Use it so that you will be equipped to engage in the battle before you. Paul went on. He went on and he emphasized the importance of taking up the armor of God. He repeats it again in verse 13, where we read this: "Therefore, take up the whole armor of God." This statement, repeated, would have likely left no doubt in the minds of the followers of Christ in Ephesus that this was a critical step for them to take. Following through with this action would be the only thing that would help the believers to stand true to God when the day of evil came. God's armor would provide them with what they needed in order to be found standing after the dust settled from the battle they would be engaged in with the enemy. Paul then went on to list the specific pieces of armor that would help the believers stand against the enemy. It was necessary that they be intentional in putting on each piece of the armor. And by doing so, they would ensure that they were fully prepared. They were to begin by fastening themselves with the belt of truth, which was a foundational piece that would give them the solid ground from which to do battle, the truth of God. Putting on the breastplate of righteousness would help them to guard their vital organs from being contaminated by the attacks of the enemy. As shoes for their feet, the gospel of peace would help them to be ready to serve with humility and sacrifice as the Lord called them to each situation. Taking up the shield of faith would be another tool to protect them from whatever fiery darts the enemy would shoot at them. Along with this, putting on the helmet of salvation would protect them from the attacks of the enemy on their minds. Paul concluded the explanation of the armor by encouraging the believers to utilize the sword of the Spirit. In other words, the Word of God. These pieces of God's armor, faithfully put in place, would help them in the battle against the evil one. There was one more thing he urged the Christ followers to use in the spiritual battle, and this was the tool of prayer. Praying at all times in the Spirit, with all prayer and supplication. This was a spiritual exercise that they were called to practice earnestly and intentionally. He called them to keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. Said another way, they were to stay sharp in prayer and to persevere through the difficult trials they would experience at the hands of the evil one, at the hands of Satan. Then Paul also asked them to pray for him personally. After all, he was in prison. His request, however, was far from anything selfish. He asked his fellow Christ followers to pray that he would be given the right words to speak when the opportunity presented itself for him to share the gospel. This was why he was in prison, the gospel. And he did not want to waste this opportunity to make a difference for the Lord. He urged them to pray that he would declare the message with boldness. As these believers followed the directions from the Lord sent through Paul, they would find themselves equipped to engage in the spiritual battle before them. The certainty with which the truth of the Lord comes to us through Paul should leave us with no questions in regards to the reason we are to put on the full armor of God. It is a simple fact. Doing so will help us to stand during the battle and will find us still standing following the battle. Putting on each piece of the armor is an essential step which we must carefully listen to. We can be intentional about putting on each piece with care. We begin with the belt of truth, for it is a central piece of the armor. God's truth is the foundation from which we battle. This is the place from which we are to serve Him and to do battle against Satan. The breastplate of righteousness is necessary as a piece of defense against the enemy's attacks. This piece helps to protect our vital organs from being struck as we fight. Fitting our feet with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace is another important step. This piece of armor provides us with firm footing when we find ourselves in the midst of the battle against Satan. Standing on the sure foundation of the gospel of peace gives us the balance we need and the readiness we need to give ourselves to the task that God has called us to. Then taking up the shield of faith gives us another critical piece with which to defend ourselves. Having our faith securely placed in God will help us to extinguish the fiery darts that the enemy fires our way. What are the flaming darts the devil shoots at us? There's many. They could be things like fear or doubt or confusion. And it doesn't take us very long to find where Satan is trying to use those exact kind of things against us. Sometimes he uses words against us. When we allow these arrows to hit us, the enemy gains a foothold in our lives, and the destruction has begun. That is why it is so crucial that we carry the shield of faith that God has provided for us. It's to protect us. Then there's also the helmet of salvation. This is the salvation we acquire when we receive Jesus as our Savior. The salvation from our sin, the salvation to eternal life. This is the truth that we received with our minds. The head, the mind, is one of the most vulnerable parts of our body in war. Therefore, it is important that we protect our minds with the helmet of salvation. The devil makes many attempts to feed our minds with his sugar-coated lies. All the more reason for us to carefully put on the helmet of salvation and hang on to the life-giving truth that Jesus has imparted to us. Then there is the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, that we must take up. The Word of God completes our armor because it is the weapon we require in order to effectively battle against Satan. The Word of God, which is sharper than any two-edged sword, is an amazing weapon. The one who learns to wield it with skill and use it along with the other pieces of the armor will realize victory over Satan. Paul concludes with his call for us to exercise empowering prayer or persevering prayer. It is the final ingredient that brings together the full armor of God for its greatest effectiveness. Prayer is the essential Christian discipline that undergirds and covers us in the course of the spiritual battles we daily encounter. Each of us is being challenged and encouraged to pray on each piece of the armor daily. To be praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. That is, pray in the Spirit. Allow the Spirit to guide you, to empower you, to strengthen you. Then, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. Make others within the family of God a main focus of your praying. Then also ask prayer for yourself. Pray for opportunities to share the gospel message and for the right words to share at that moment when you have an opportunity to share it. Pray that you would be able to make the message clear. Along with this, ask others to pray that you will be bold as you proclaim the mystery of the gospel. When we put on each piece of God's armor, exercising the discipline of earnest and persevering prayer, we will be relying on Him to provide us with all we need to do battle against Satan. In other words, we will be armed and ready for the spiritual battles that come our way. Let me encourage each of us to take the truth of God so that we can be equipped to engage in the spiritual battles before us. A while ago, National Geographic ran an article about the Alaskan bull moose. The males of the species battle for dominance during the fall breeding season, literally going head to head with antlers crunching together as they collide. Often the antlers, their only weapon, are broken. That ensures defeat. The heftiest moose, with the largest and strongest antlers, triumphs. Therefore, the battle fought in the fall is really won during the summer, when the moose eat continually. The one that consumes the best diet for growing antlers and gaining weight will be the heavyweight in the fight. Those that eat inadequately sport weaker antlers and less bulk. There's a lesson here for us. Spiritual battles await. Satan will choose a season to attack. Will we be victorious or will we fail? Much depends on what we do now before the war begins. The bull moose principle, enduring faith, strength, and wisdom for trials, are best developed before they're needed. Intentionally putting on each piece of the armor of God through prayer and continually exercising the discipline of persevering prayer will ensure that we are well equipped. Take the steps today to apply the truth of God's word to your life so that you will be equipped to engage in the spiritual battle before you. Armed and Ready is a title that is drawn from the military world. It suggests the idea of being equipped, alert, and prepared for whatever battle might lie over that next horizon. In many ways, this picture of military preparedness fits well the scenario of the Christ follower. It fits well this idea of us daily facing spiritual battles. The spiritual battle before each one of us is a daily assignment for which we are implored, exhorted to be ready. The enemy is as real as the people we encounter each day. Satan is a foe that is determined to take down as many as possible. However, we have the help that is readily available. The Word of God through the Apostle Paul gives us solid counsel on how to handle these spiritual battles and how to be equipped for them. To be strong in the Lord requires that we listen to the call, put on the armor of God, and be aware of who our enemy is. God has provided us with a full suit of armor that will help us to be prepared for whatever the evil one throws our way. Put on each piece of the armor through prayer. Pray continually with all kinds of prayers. Pray for the saints and ask the saints to pray for you. Pray for the opportunities to share the gospel and the boldness to do so. Learn to consistently practice earnest persevering prayer. Equipped with the armor of God and empowered through prayer, we as followers of Christ will be ready to engage the enemy, Satan. Be alert, be intentional, and be specific as you apply the truth of God's word. When you do so, you will be ensuring that you are equipped to engage in the spiritual battle before you. Amen.
Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Today we have the wonderful privilege of celebrating communion together once again. And it's a special time for us to get together on a regular basis to remember what our Father has given us in his Son, Jesus Christ. The invitation goes out to each one today who has received Jesus as their personal Savior and Lord to come and to be a part of this meal. And so I invite you as Jesus invites us to come and to be a part of these special moments together. In Psalm 130, we have one chapter in the scriptures that really help in our preparing for this meal. It helps us in the sense that it helps us to put our hearts in the right place. And so I just want to read Psalm 130 and then share a few thoughts in regards to this precious psalm. Psalm 130, we read, "Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my pleas for mercy. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, or, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord. More than watchmen wait for the morning, more than watchmen wait for the morning. O Israel, put your hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption. And he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities." Psalm 130, first of all, is a penitential psalm. It's a psalm that is intended to help us to be able to express sorrow for our sin. Psalm 130 is also known as a psalm of ascent. It's one of the psalms of ascent. That simply means that the people in Jesus' day would be walking up to the temple, and as they walked up to the temple, this would be one of the psalms that they would take turns reciting. It was a psalm that helped them to put themselves in the right place when it came to being in the presence of the Lord. The psalm begins, verses 1 through 4, where it is a prayer for the Lord to have mercy. In a sense, the first two verses are lament, just offering the lament, the sorrow that one feels for one's sin. Verses 3 and 4 bring in the whole aspect of confessing one's sin. And then as we move on into verses 5 through 8, there's this sense of waiting for the Lord with this expectant hope. It's a wonderful hope that we can expect when we trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. There's also a sense, clearly in verses 7 and 8, this confidence in the redemption that is brought to us through Jesus alone. As we come to our God this day, let us come as those who are truly sorry for our sin. As we celebrate Jesus today, let us remember who He is, and let us remember all that God has accomplished for us through Him. Take the time to allow the Holy Spirit to direct the examination of your lives as you think about your hearts and where you stand with the Lord right now. I often use Psalm 139, the last two verses there, to help us in that. And those verses simply say this: "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." Let's confess our sins to the Lord this day. Father, we do come to you recognizing that you are the great and sovereign God, that you are a gracious and merciful and loving Heavenly Father. And so we come to you today confessing to you the sins that we have committed in the past days, in the past weeks, in the past hours, in the past moments of our lives. Father, we come to you confessing our sin to you because we have this confidence in the redemption that you have provided for us through Jesus Christ. We have confidence and we trust in your word, the promises that you've made in your word. And so, Father, today we just cling to the truth of your word, and we received this assurance of forgiveness as we recite those words from that familiar passage in 1 John where it says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us, cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thank you, Father. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As we come to this time of celebration, we have the elements that have been prepared for us. We have the bread and we have the cup. And as we continue our celebration together, I want us to just turn to the Gospel of Matthew, where we read about Jesus and his disciples being together for the Last Supper. And I'm just going to read a short portion of that, but this will help guide us in our celebration of the communion meal today. Matthew 26, verse 26, it says, "Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, 'Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.'" As we think about the bread and the cup that has been prepared, that you have prepared for yourselves at home or in someone else's home, that has been prepared here. These are powerful symbols that remind us of what God has done for us through Jesus. They remind us of the sacrifice that Jesus has made on our behalf. We think of the bread that symbolizes the body of the Lord Jesus Christ that he gave for us, willingly, sacrificially. We think also of the cup that represents the new covenant in Jesus' blood. The blood, the perfect blood of the Lamb that he shed for us so that we would not have to take that penalty on ourselves. These are simply elements that remind us in a powerful way what Jesus has done for us. And so today we're going to pray and give thanks for these elements, and then we will partake together of the bread and the cup that we've prepared. Let's pray. Father, we do give you thanks and praise for your faithfulness to us, for your goodness to us, for the ways in which you have provided us with redemption, plentiful redemption, as the psalmist says, through your Son, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father, for what this bread and what this cup represent today. These powerful symbols that remind us of what you have done and what Jesus has given willingly. And so today we simply say thank you. Thank you for the bread that symbolizes the body of Jesus that was given so freely for us. Thank you for the cup that symbolizes his precious blood that was shed for us once and for all to look after the problem of sin. We thank you, Father. And we thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for teaching us, reminding us once again of what precious truth we have to celebrate and of what a precious Savior we have to celebrate in the person of Jesus Christ. It's in his powerful name that we pray. Amen. As you take the bread, take it and eat it, giving thanks to Jesus for his body willingly given for you. And then together we take the cup that symbolizes the new covenant in Jesus' blood. As you drink today, drink with thankfulness in your heart to God. Drink with thankfulness in your heart to Jesus, expressing and giving thanks to him for this precious gift of his perfect blood. Father, we thank you for the privilege of being able to celebrate together the Lord's table this day. We thank you for the importance of remembering what you have done through your Son, Jesus Christ, remembering the sacrifice that Jesus has made on our behalf. We pray that as we go on in the days to come, that we would continue to just hold before us the power of what has been accomplished for us and the power of this gospel message that you would want us to share with others. Father, please empower us by your Spirit towards that end, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing together.
Chasm that lay between us. shadows of my soul.
As we part company again for this week, let me just share a few words with you. The words that we have been studying lately from the letter of Ephesians that Paul has written is an important letter for us as a church. It's something that truly gives us very practical handles, very practical truth for daily living. The passage that we looked at today is extremely important when it comes to this matter of putting on the armor of God. And I would encourage you to daily begin practicing, adding to your practices, the steps that can help to equip you to engage in the battle against Satan. Each of us needs to stand together with one another in this, in the important aspect of prayer. I would just encourage you, challenge you to seek to grow as disciples of Jesus Christ. As we go on into this next week, let me just conclude with these words from the Apostle Paul when he says this at the end of the chapter 3 in Ephesians. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, now and forevermore. Amen.